So, Joe, I see you finally made it up here with a little bit of, I think, I don't know if it was, confused or we went the wrong way, but, it was raining. You was, I noticed you was at the wrong BAM, and that was on Lafayette. Mm-hmm. And we here on Fulton Street and Rockwell Place. So I think that's where the confusion went at. Tell me about that. I don't know what happened.
It's very interesting. When people think of BAM, mm-hmm. they think of the big opera house.
Hey.
And so when you said it was across the street from BAM,
yes,
it was easy enough. I didn't have to ask for an address or mm-hmm. anything else. I just come in. Across the street from BAM was supposed to be this building, except for one thing. Where I was supposed to be mm-hmm. wasn't across the street from the BAM that everybody knows.
So yes.
That's where the confusion came.
Okay. Okay.
If you had said Fulton Street now.
Yeah. Okay. So that was my fault.
Somewhere in my memory banks, mm-hmm. oh, that must be that smaller building that he's talking about. But I still wouldn't have known that the interest to this facility
yes.
was around the corner, but
yeah,
all is well that ends well. And yeah. I'm here now, yeah. you're here
hey,
now,
hey,
and yeah. All is good.
All is good.
All is good.
Okay, so I'm glad that we did get that out the way, so yeah. you are here. So, formally, my name is Melvin Isaac. This is for the community out there in the world. This is the Artistic Talent Show, and I have an extraordinary guest over here, an artist, a powerful, powerful person to me, that I met at Dorsey Art Gallery. And he's going to share his story and his message to the community. So I am very happy. I'm very honored to have you as my guest here, Joe.
Well, thank you, Melvin.
You're welcome.
And I am very pleased to be here.
Mm-hmm.
Any opportunity that I have personally to share my story with other people, I take, because I believe communication, understanding of one another, and my particular purpose in life
mm-hmm.
is just to simply help anybody that I meet.
Yes, yes.
So that's my basic philosophy in life.
Okay.
My name is Joseph Bell-Bey,
mm-hmm.
and I am here in my capacity as an artist.
Yes.
And as that goes, I have a very uplifting story and reason to why I am currently now an artist. And I'll give you the short version of that story.
Right. But before you give yeah. me the short version of it, let me ask you the questions here, because they're going to fall into your story.
Fine.
Oh, you're definitely going to fall into your story.
That
so what three words friends and family would use to describe you, Joe?
Well, I'll answer that question in this way. What appears to be the underlying reason for me being here, other than love of my fellow man, is my particular demeanor. And I am here as an observer and a witness to everything that goes on. The way my mind works is that everything that comes before my eyes or my ears is studied. And the reason why I say observer and witness is because although I take all this information in, whether it be just looking at you or looking at the equipment in this room, it's like a computer.
Okay.
It registers everything, but what it does not do is judge.
Hmm.
That's why I say observer, witness. I don't make any judgment calls. I just take everything in. And I've been that way all my life.
Okay, great, great, great answer. How would you describe yourself?
I would say that I'm a helper, a facilitator. And I get great joy out of being placed in that position in order to help people. My last job, which lasted for 36 years, was in the U.S. Postal Service.
Okay.
But I wasn't boxing mail. I was a union rep for 36 years. Wow. So I was in a position for 36 years. Mm-hmm. Every time I went to work, there was somebody there that needed my help, and I was able to help them. And I got great joy from doing it.
Oh, great. What inspired you to wake up every morning?
Wow. I would imagine knowing that in some way, somehow, during the course of the day, I keep going back to the same thing because that's who I am. I'll be in a position to do good for somebody, someone, or for a group.
Okay. Who would you say inspired you?
My immediate family, my mother, two sisters. My father wasn't with me, and I had a much older brother, but he was out doing what much older brothers always do. And so I was raised by three very, very strong Black women. And that would be my mother and my two older sisters. And everything that I am today, everything that I aspire to be in some way came through them or because of them. And the manner in which they raised me, protected me, taught me. So they were the base from which I sprang.
Yes. So what challenges have you struggled with to become an artist?
When I became an artist,
yes.
When I had aspirations to create art, was no struggle. I'm a well-rounded artist, but my love is abstract art, and abstract art is playtime. From when I initially started right up to now. Now, if there was any struggle to be made, would be in figurative art or realistic art. You know, buildings, figures, people, things that others could recognize and say, hey, he drew a book. Hey, he drew Melvin. That was a challenge to a degree. But as with everything else, you learn the rules first.
Right.
And when you learn the rules, which is 70% of anything you do, including being an artist, is learning the rules. Knowing what a pencil can do. Knowing how to apply the pencil. A paintbrush. Knowing what paint will do. So once you learn those rules, then practice makes you perfect.
There you go.
But learning the rules is 70% of the job. Practice is that extra 30% that will take you over the top.
So tell me, how long have you been an artist?
I started painting, creating art on purpose, let's say, on June 24th, 2005.
Okay.
At the time, I was 60 years old. And there's a story behind that, which I had started to tell you before. In 2004, I realized that something was wrong physically with me. And I started going to doctors. They could not figure out what was wrong. That lasted for about a year. And about a month before April 1st, 2005, I started getting really sick. And the doctors couldn't figure out what was happening. 2 weeks before April 1st, 2006, I basically stopped eating. Not because I didn't try to eat, because everything came up. And they still couldn't figure out what was going on. And the end of March in 2005, probably March 28th around then, I had made up my mind that I was going to die. And so I started putting things together. At that time, I was president of the Brooklyn local of the American Postal Workers Union. And I had the responsibility of approximately 3,000 members and their families to deal with. And my sudden absence from that position and duties would have given others the opportunity to take advantage of my people. So what I did was I basically called the meeting of my offices at my house because I couldn't go to the union office. And I laid out a plan for them to follow. There would be a secession because I was going to move out of the way. And as president, I had the ability to promote. So I promoted my second in command to my position on up the line. And so that there would be a smooth transition and the people would not lose any representation by my absence. And that morning, I called, I told my wife I was going to the hospital. And I was going to the hospital so that she wouldn't come home from work and find a dead body in the hospital. Now, at that time, I hadn't eaten in 14 to 20 days. I had lost sight in my left eye, and my right eye, I could just see a blurry, you know, double vision. And when I got to the hospital, the symptoms at that time was so overt out there in the open for everybody to see. The doctors in the emergency room knew exactly what was wrong. They sent me for an MRI, and they found that a very large tumor was growing on my pituitary gland to the point where it invaded my optic nerve cavities. And that's why I was blinded. So let me give you the short version. That was the buildup. 3 days later, on March 31st, it looked like I was going to die. When my wife came home from the hospital that day, she called everybody. Mm. If you want to see him, you better come to the hospital tomorrow, because I don't know how long he is going to be here. And on April 1st, 2005, funny, April Fool's Day, around 3 o'clock in the morning, I decided I was going to say my prayers for the last time. It was the 23rd Psalm. And when I said amen, I was no longer in the hospital bed. I was in a courtroom setting. And I said, okay, I died. And they're judging me. And there was a group of people over to the right, and slightly over to the left was this tall podium where the judge was. But the podium was so tall, I could not see the judge behind the podium. And at that time, the scroll came down, and I instantly knew it was everything that I had did in my entire life was written on that scroll. And I know my knees was knocking. I had a guard on my left, a guard on my right. And I said, okay, I'm going straight to hell. And judge said, I want you to take this test. And somehow it felt like I was using a computer, but no mouse, no keyboard, with my mind. I don't know, remember the questions. I don't know how it went. But when I finished taking the test, the judge said, you did good. You have two choices. You can go back and live out the rest of your life, or you can accept the promotion. I decided to go back and live out the rest of my life. And he ordered the scribe to seal the scroll. And that was the first time in this whole scenario that I felt comfortable. Because for me, that was like going to juvie court where they seal the records. And you don't, anything that's in there, you don't have to ever worry it about again in life. So on April 1st in 2005, I began a new life with no past. Because that scroll was sealed. I woke up that morning in the hospital, and they brought in breakfast. I struggled. I was very weak. I struggled to get that styrofoam cover off, and I ate everything that was there, and I had eaten everything on that little table, and nothing came back up.
There you go.
And my wife arrived there. She looked at the table where I had food on it. She looked at the breakfast thing, and she was angry going to the, she, who ate my husband's food? Because she knew it wasn't me. And I told her, no, no, Valerie, it was me.
I ate.
And that day, the people who were coming, to say their last goodbyes, found me sitting up in the bed and talking to them, interacting with them. On the day, 3 days later, I was scheduled for a brain operation to get that tumor out. And that was on April 1st. Now, excuse me, 3 days later, that would have been April 3rd or 4th. Instead of being pushed into the operating room, I was released from the hospital. So, in that courtroom setting, a miracle took place.
Yes, it was a miracle.
And I recovered completely. My eyesight came back. The tumor slowly diminished and disappeared.
Yeah.
And, but in that courtroom setting, when they brought me back, they brought me back with gifts.
Oh, yeah.
That over time, it took time for me to realize what those gifts were. But right now, from that day, April 1st, 2005, up until now, I've been living in a state of grace.
Come on now.
Now, how I became an artist, 2 months after I got out of the hospital, on June 24th, 2005, I was downtown Brooklyn paying a gas bill. And when I came out of the building, I was walking to the bus stop, and somebody yelled really loud in my ear from behind, "Go in and buy stuff." And I turned to look to see who was yelling in my ear, and there was nobody there. I looked up to see where I was, and I was in front of an art supply store. I took one step towards the bus, and I said, "Well, it won't hurt just to go in the store and look around." I went in, bought stuff, and came out, went home, and I did about 5 paintings.
Wow.
Now, my wife is an art collector and curator and gallery owner at the time. And she came home, she looked at the work that was on our dining room table and said, "Who did this?" And I said, "I did." She said, "No, you didn't." And when she looked at the brushes and the paint and the pads and stuff that I had there, she realized I did. At that time, she called Art O'Neill's and called McIntosh over because they lived in the area. They said, "This was some good abstract work." And 2 months after that, I had my first one-man show.
Wow.
And every month after that, for about a year and a half, I had a show every single month after that.
Wow.
And what's amazing is that it all came natural. The abstract, not the figurative. Okay.
Right.
It all came easy. I wasn't really taught in the normal sense. Nobody sat me down and said, "This is how you do it." I never went to school for art. What would happen is every 3 days when I woke, I had a new skill. So I was being taught in my sleep by powers unseen. And that's the miracle of what went on and how I became an artist.
There you go. Well, this leads into this question right there is, who are you and what is your purpose in life? Leads right in there.
I'm a teacher.
Okay.
With emphasis on helping. I have a vast repertoire of skills and knowledge that I try to help others with, to teach others with, so that they can stand up and be whomever or whatever they want to be. And I believe that's my purpose in life.
Okay. All right. Hold up for 1 second. Let me make sure we got good timing. All right. When did you start drawing?
After I had my 2 months after I started creating art, which was abstract, I decided that if I wanted to call myself an artist, I had to be able to do figurative work.
Okay.
And I got books. I had assistance from Carl McIntosh and Art O'Neill's. And I read the books. I learned the language of the skills. And then I started to practice. And with relative ease, I began to create figurative works of art, graphite drawings, watercolor, acrylic.
Okay.
On paper, canvas, whatever.
Okay.
But that was something that I had to learn. The abstract was a gift from God.
Yes. How many mediums did you work in? A lot. Huh?
Good question. I do a little sculpting.
Okay.
Like I said, I do figurative work and graphite, pastel, watercolor, and acrylic. Okay. I work with wood and clay in the sculpting. I do prints, wood cuts, lino cuts, and probably a whole lot of other things that I have forgotten.
Do you belong to any art organizations?
Well, there's only one that I would consider myself a party to.
Okay.
And that's the historic Dorsey Art Gallery in Brooklyn, New York.
Yeah. Have you had any commissions?
No. I mean, you talk about small stuff. But nothing that I would consider to be a commission.
Okay. So what about work in private and public collections?
Oh, wow. I should have brought a list with me. Right now I'm stumped, but I had work in two Fillmore galleries, Grace Baptist Church, York College, New York University, Abyssinian. My work is in the Abyssinian Baptist Church collection.
Yeah.
Wow.
Yeah.
I mean,
you got a lot.
I probably have a list that can fill up two pages, and I've forgotten because it's just too numerous venues to actually remember. I write all of this stuff down. Yeah.
No problem. No problem. Tell us about Dorsey. How important is Dorsey Gallery to you?
Well, that's easy. The Dorsey Art Gallery opened its doors in 1970.
Okay.
The founder of that gallery's interests were children, art, and golf, in that order. And his interest in art spread out further than most gallery owners would be, because he was a master framer. And like me, he loved to teach. So he would teach anybody that would listen, whether they were artists, whether they were collectors. You were always welcome. And this is a key word. You were always welcome at the Dorsey Art Gallery. The Dorsey Art Gallery is the oldest continuously run, black-owned and operated art gallery in the entire metropolitan area. If you think about it, at least a third of the people walking the earth today were not born when Dorsey opened those doors in 1970. So that's over 50 years of helping young and established artists in the community and in the United States. All of the biggies have gone through the Dorsey Art Gallery, Ernie Krishlow, Ann Tanksley, James Denmark, and Jacob Lawrence, Bearden, Elizabeth Catlett, all of these great, great artists, Jonathan Green, all of these great artists have pierced those doors and had their works hung on those walls. So as a Black-owned and operated gallery, it is truly historic in nature.
Yes, I'm feeling blessed already hearing the spoken words from you, you know, and plus your journey and your spiritual journey, the whole work. So it's a privilege. So this last question here, well, actually, is I think is maybe one or two. What do you consider to be the most important in your life of art?
I would have to say my abstract work.
Okay.
And that's based on the fact that I was taught this skill by unseen forces. And I have watched over and over and over again how people are affected by it when they see it. It for them, it can be uplifting. At my first one-man show at the Fillmore Gallery, a young lady came in off the street. She stood in front of one of my paintings and just started to cry. And she asked, "Is the artist there?" And she came over to me and she said, "I just wanted you to know that I'm an artist, but I had stopped working. And looking at your art, it gave me the inspiration to go home, take out the paint, the brushes, and the canvases, and start to work." And in many instances, similar stories I have heard about how people react to the work. Mm-hmm. And it's my belief that every piece of abstract art that I complete is destined to help one person. And eventually it will do that because my abilities are gifts from God. Yeah. And in many ways, I believe that I'm a conduit. Mm-hmm. That there's a purpose behind the abstract art that goes far beyond me.
Yeah, right. What we're going to do is a couple of things. Okay. One is that your message is here. You have a powerful, powerful story and a powerful message to give to the community and the young artists of every ethnicity, you know, towards building their own lifestyle and going to art, because there's a purpose for everybody. And you already told your purpose, the way I feel that is really coming from God, that saved you, that brought you back. And it's a reason why you are here. It's a reason why you are talking to me, because now you're not just talking to me, you're talking to over 3 million people. So it's a reason for this. Why we having this interview. And I think it's a bigger than what we think it is, but you are one of the vessels that's going to share your message to the community. So what I want to do now, before we talk a little bit about some of your artwork that is shown on this wall right here, is look in this camera right here and give a message to the community. What message would you give them as far as becoming an artist and what you just went through? So what message would you give them?
Creating art is an act of love. And through that creative process, you gain so much on a personal level That's incredible. When I paint, when I paint abstract art, I am dancing, I am singing. I hardly pay attention to what I am doing because the forces of God / love is actually working through me. I happen to paint abstract work flat. And it's really incredible. The only thing that I do when it comes to abstract work that I can claim to be my own is I picked out the medium. I pick out the paper and what size. I pick out the canvas and what size. But everything else, my choice of colors, the design within the artwork, is something that works through me. I be enjoying the process, loving it. I be singing, I be dancing. I'm spiritually uplifted and happy. And I know when to stop. And I know when the piece is complete. It's when the name of the piece pops in my head. I've learned to stop right there. And that's the first time that I really look at the work and see what was created through me.
You have an extraordinary story. Extraordinary. Mm-hmm. You got 24 artwork pieces, right? Mm-hmm. So if you got within 10 minutes to talk about, or real short, you know, about your mm-hmm. artwork that is mm-hmm. being displayed, you can sum it all up, you know, in a way where people would understand it.
Well, let me put it to you this way. Mm-hmm. All my life, I have always wanted to be in a position to help others and assist others where I can, teach others. And with the artwork that I am creating now, yeah, it gives me a much, much more dramatic tool mm-hmm. to also allow people to see what I see and feel what I feel, because the artwork represents glimpses into the world that I actually live in. So when you see my art, you see little tiny niblets of who I am on the inside. Mm-hmm. And that gives me an opportunity to share me with everyone that sees my art.
Well said. You definitely shared it with me, the world, with everything else, with everybody. And it's been a privilege. It's been an honor to have you on my show. I am very pleased. Thank you very much.
Well, I am very honored to be here.
Yes.
And you're a good host, because normally, I'm a very nervous type person. Mm. I like to stay in the background and help from behind. Mm. And any organization that I am, I like the glue.
Yes.
Wherever something is needed, that's where I step in. But I always have a sort of nervous reaction to public speaking. Mm-hmm. Although I know personally, and people have told me that I do it very well, but still inside, I'd rather not.
Yes.
And but I learned a little trick. And that trick is, I don't prepare notes for public speaking. Not that I don't have an outline in my mind, but just before I walked through that door, I said, Father, from your mind to my lips.
There you go.
And that chills me.
Yes, it did. Yes, it did. Yeah, I felt that too from you. You know, it's a spiritual connection here, you know. And I think that's what made you really calm and collected. And it's coming from the heart. And once you feel that, the environment that you are in, or the person, the host, like myself, that is speaking with you, it lets you know that we okay. We all on the same wavelength, so we good, you know. And I think that's what makes you tell your story even much better. So I want to thank you again. It was a pleasure, an honor to have you as my guest. Thank you very much.
And I want to thank you for this opportunity.
Yes.
And to share me with everyone that this piece reaches.
Mm-hmm.
And today, share part of me with you.
There you go.
Thank you.
Well, God is watching.
Oh, yeah.
He's there. Thank you.